first book being released in September 14th, 2008, followed by the first movie being released March 23rd, 2012, Hunger Games was one of the first of its kind, the genre of dystopian revolution, young adult fiction. Here's some original reviews from when the book first came out in 2008.
It occurs to me that there has never been a quintessential futuristic gladiator book for kids. That is undoubtedly the roughest term you can give this book.
The considerable strength of the novel comes in Collins's convincingly detailed world-building and her memorably complex and fascinating heroine. This makes for an exhilarating narrative and a future we can fear and believe in, but it also allows us to see the similarities between Katniss's world and ours.
At first glance, it might be easy to dismiss The Hunger Games as a credible example of political theory, let alone critical race theory. However, I, as well as many scholars, believe that the medium in which theory is delivered should not be discredited simply because it has been made into a more accessible form. Take this quote, for example, by modern political philosopher Natalie Wynn.
Talking to voters teaches you the hard realities of what your fellow Americans actually care about. And when I was canvassing, I did talk to some left-wing people, you know, I talked to union families. You know, most people do not read theory. Most people are concerned primarily with themselves and their families. They want personal security and prosperity. What you want is socialism, or even just social democracy. Then you have a lot of work ahead of you in terms of outreach. You have to engage people, educate, raise awareness. But you don't want to do that, because it requires that you stop owning the libs and start actually communicating with them.
Of course, it's wonderful to be able to quote Marx, Orwell, Freire. Political theory is interesting and stands the test of time because of its writing. But it is undeniable that not all of it is accessible to the average person in language or meaning. Mainstream media is often overlooked as a means to introduce political or critical race theory into the general public eye. I personally feel that Collins' writing is particularly brilliant at targeting young audiences and introducing major social justice topics in an accessible way for younger adults. Now, Suzanne Collins' Hunger Games is not a perfect piece of media. There are plenty of critiques to be said about its primarily white perspective of revolution. However, the intention of a piece of art extends past how its readers interpret it. Take this quote from a modern art critic and video essayist known as CJ the X.
The moment the art touches an audience, the ownership shifts in an irreversible way. That audience is not having an art experience with you and your intentions. They're having an art experience with the art object. If you've done your job right, that art object is going to contain plenty of your intention. But the object, independently of your involvement, is going to suck an audience that connects with it into an essence whirlpool that may or may not perfectly align with your intentions and dreams as a creator.
So even if Suzanne Collins' intention was to simply make a simple little YA novel, though I strongly believe that that was not the case, her impact on culture and her audience's interpretation of her work elevates her content. This interpretation of The Hunger Games is going to take Suzanne Collins' text, intentions, and well-known information about her work and elevate it under a social and critical theory lens. As I am not a person of color, though I am completing this video essay for a race and relations class, I can only do my best to interpret this under the lens of allyship, not from personal experience. The premise of the Hunger Games world rests on the splitting of the nation into 12 known districts. The major conglomeration of these districts called Panem. Later in the third book, it is revealed that a 13th underground revolutionary district exists in hiding. But for the sake of analyzing this political system, I will mainly be addressing the first 12. The 12 districts decline in quality as they go on, ruled by a major district entitled the Capital. The purpose of the other districts is to produce goods for the main purpose of funding the Capital as well as the other districts.
Citizens. Tonight, I address all of Panem as one. Since the dark days, Panem has had an unprecedented era of peace It is a peace built upon cooperation and a respect for law and order. Your actions are based on a misunderstanding of how we have survived together. It is a contract. Each district supplies the capital, like blood to a heart. In return, the capital provides order and security. To refuse work is to put the entire system in danger. The capital is the beating heart of Pan Am. Nothing can survive without a heart. Order shall be restored. To those who ignore the warnings of history, prepare to pay the ultimate price.
Founding of Pan Am is an interesting one, as it is the direct result of a previous failed revolution. The capital had been ruling and the districts were unhappy. They rioted and revolutionized themselves, however, did not succeed the war. As a punishment for this revolution, the capital enacted the Hunger Games, which was a grim reminder to the citizens of the districts what would happen if they tried to fight back. You have this political system founded on an ideology of fear, essentially making examples of them to remind them what happens if they try to fight back against this higher power. And obviously, this is not a new way of ruling. Making examples of citizens as a result of a previous historical event in which these citizens had nothing to do with is very common in the United States historically. Splitting up of resources between the districts is intentional, as it means that no one district can be more powerful without the other, except for the capital. Let's analyze this quote, for example, provided by James Henry Hammond, who was a defender of slavery.
The greatest strength of the South arises from the harmony of her political and social institutions. This harmony gives her a frame of society, the best in the world, and an extent of political freedom, combined with entire security, such as no other people ever enjoyed upon the face of the earth. In all social systems there must be a class to do the menial duties, to perform the drudgery of life. Such a class you must have, or you would not have that other class which leads progress. Fortunately for the South, she found a race adapted to that purpose to her hand. A race inferior to her own, to answer all her purposes.
The reasoning rings similar to President Snow's reasoning for why the districts must operate as they do. First book does not focus much on the other districts except for the elaboration of districts 11 and 12, which are incredibly important in our analysis of this series under the lens of race and ethnicity. District 11 is the largest district and is known for agriculture and livestock. It should be noted that within the books and the movies, this district is also populated mainly by people of color. District 12, which is Katniss's district, is known for coal mining. It should be noted that from the books, many fans derive descriptions of the characters that live in District 12, as well as their way of living, similar to indigenous and Native American individuals. Going back to District 11, the first notable point to make about it is its geographical location. Largely making up the southeastern portion of the country, let's take a look at this map next to a more modern map of the United States. Here we have a map from 1837, marking which states were considered slave states versus free states. The alignment of District 11 and District 12 is nearly identical. I don't think it's much of a coincidence that these two maps align similarly to the economic treatment of individuals within the founding of the United States. The following quote from video essayist Nelly Kurenko draws comparisons between the capital in the Hunger Games and American colonialism and exploitation.
In the real-world colonial paradigm, it's usually a foreign power that exploits a weaker power for its land and its resources. One real-world example being Britain exploiting and colonizing India. But in the Hunger Games, it is the government itself that is exploiting its own people within the bounds of its own nation. Another stark example of this that is elaborated on in the series are the coal mines of District 12. District 12 specializes in coal mining because of its location in the Appalachian Mountains, as mentioned in the first book. Many of the residents tirelessly work in the mines every day to provide all of Pan Am with the coal necessary to fuel many of its industries. For providing such an important resource for Pan Am, they receive very little in return, and most mine workers live in District 12 slum, with barely enough food to feed their families. So, in Pan Am's social and economic structure, the colonized, which in this case is represented by the district citizens, are exploited for gain by the colonial power, which in this case is the capital.
Rue is a 12-year-old girl that Katniss meets within her journey through the Hunger Games. Katniss and Rue befriend one another. Though the two form an allyship within the arena, it is short-lived, as Rue is very quickly killed after forming an alliance with Katniss. One of the most prominent moments within the first book, and arguably one of the first indicators of the beginnings of the revolution, Katniss performs a sort of mourning ritual for Rue once she dies, covering her dead body in flowers and waiting and singing by her side until she is taken away. Thresh, the other individual from Rue's district, spares Katniss during a battle, only once, as he says, out of respect for what she did for Rue. Analyzing Rue's character through a racial and ethnic lens is critically important to her role within the story. Let's take a look at this snippet from Yuharu Zaid's fabulous video essay, The Day Rue Became Black.
The thing is, Rue and Thresh were described as being black in the book. If you want to get technical about it, they were described as having dark brown skin. Characters like Rue and Thresh, if they had been cast with white actors, would have been far from the first characters in the history of cinema to be whitewashed. The sad thing is that if they had been whitewashed, the fans wouldn't even have noticed. She's the 12-year-old, the one who reminded me so of Prim in stature. Up close, she looks about 10. She has bright, dark eyes and satiny brown skin. She has dark brown skin. Yes, Rue is a dark-skinned black girl. The racism toward her character didn't begin, nor did it end with Amela Stenberg being in the movie. It began in the casting room, where the decision was made to cast a light-skinned biracial actress for the role. As a character, Thresh keeps to himself, keeps quiet, and is known for his huge stature that sees him towering over everyone. It appeared to be more palatable to white fans to see a black man playing such a role. It's evident that a good portion of the vitriolic response to Rue's surprise blackness was that people, the racist, literally could not compute with the idea of Rue being this sweet, innocent little girl and also being black.
This video essay brings up an incredibly important point. With the quotes provided, we can reasonably discern that Suzanne Collins meant for these characters to be people of color. I think it is fair to say that Rue and Thresh could fall under the category of token characters of color, used to teach the other, normally white characters, how their system is bad. Let's take a look at this quote from the study, Starving for Diversity, Ideological Implications of Race Representation in the Hunger Games.
In an analysis of control, it is worth asking why the racial ambiguity in Collins' book, which avoided tokenism and Eurocentrism, changed in the conversion to the screen. The answer comes from media producer George Lucas. In an interview with Jon Stewart on The Daily Show a month before Hunger Games was released, Lucas noted the difficulty of producing his World War II film Red Tails about the African-American Tuskegee Airmen. Observing that the film took 23 years to make, Lucas revealed that none of the Hollywood studios would take a film with an all-black-led cast because they believed it would impact their profit margins. The fact that the film was too black translated directly into not being green enough for the studios, with Lucas referring to box office sales.
This quote addresses the fact that writing a book like The Hunger Games, it is undeniable that the class and social struggle of these characters can be most modernly reflected in the real world by the class and social struggles of people of color. However, when you take that piece of media and translate it to major film production, it will then be affected by the white Hollywood gaze. I can't say that my passion for this particular analysis of the Hunger Games came directly from myself. This information and analysis was largely brought to my attention by many different content creators who are people of color and who are very keen to the real world ramifications of systemic racism and how we can use them to analyze popular pieces of media. Ultimately, I do think that The Hunger Games has some pretty valid critiques and flaws, particularly from the lens of people of color. My largest complaint being, as well as the largest complaint coming from many fans, that if the movie adaptations of the books were to be redone, it makes much more sense to have a majority of the revolutionary and oppressed characters be individuals of color. However, I think analyzing these books does start a very interesting and productive conversation on what it means to revolt against a systemically oppressive system. I appreciate you taking the time to listen, and I hope that you enjoyed this analysis of The Hunger Games.